there, jump. Two thoughts. There was a 15-year-old kid. 15. Okay? He's dead. He ain't blind. He can see. But he's dead. He's mute. M-U-T-E. I mean, he can't talk. How old are you? Right in my eye. You understand me?
paragraph for that. Okay. How's he going to answer this one? Where would you want to go? There's one word I love in the English language. It's gut. Mm. Not the kind you look inside. I'm talking gut.
Yeah.
That kind of gut. I'm going to open up and see that. No, that kind of gut. I mean, gut. It is. Got the gut. Where are you? You sat there, hand was on the wrist. He worked so hard to move his hand out.
Wow.
Hey, fan! Run, run! Then the next challenge is, how is he going to cut? Because that always sounds when they cut. Even me. It's very, very hard to duck the fence of a man without saying it. Big. Mm. And so I came up with the idea. Can you try? Try my... Hey? Hey. So I told him what to do. He really wants you. Close his eyes. And me, as a nervous mama, sitting there like a nervous rat, trying to figure out any sign that would tell me that you really mean business communicating with the Lord.
Amen.
Oh. While he was playing with his eyes shut, right behind him, hallelujah, well, right there in the kitchen, I saw that. Calm and cool and collected. He looked at me and smiled. Did you pray?
Mm.
If you died now, where would you go? Mm. Oh!
Mercy.
15-year-old boy. Most people, when they see his life in that situation he's in, think his mind is gone. No good. One thing you drive on, you never underestimate him in that situation, with any age, whatever. Just because they can't move, does not mean they're dumb. They're not. So I had to work him and find out. And I knew he's a smart kid, just cannot move and communicate. But talking to him through eyes, I got it. Yeah. Leads me to this song.
The wind and rain, it's still.
More warm. The fire does something for me. I don't know about you, but me. It brings people to my mind. He's been on my mind. Many things have been on my mind. Michelin's been on my mind. I have folks sitting beside me at my fireplace many times. When I invite them, come on, sit around. But I always bring people to my mind. I know you support Michelin's, me included. And you have no idea how much that means to this old world. Being supported by me and praised by. This song is called Always. If you look on that map up there and see who you're supporting, you can find them anywhere on that globe, including you in America. We need to remember them in prayer. Because right now, everything's broken. They need prayer. I need prayer. They need prayer. Pastor, oh yeah. The high calling of God. They need prayer. Evangelists need prayer. But we need to remember that He has always been there. Amen. So I wrote this just an outro. I hope it'd be a blessing to you. I don't know if it will, but it does me. Because you have been right. The more I sing it, the more I love it. Not because it's my first song in my life, probably the only one, but because it has in me. When traveling along the country road, with the warmth from the fire, meet your face. Remember them who traveled afar, for He's always been there for them. Please be sure that His word don't go void, that we share to some lost souls. Please be sure that His word don't go void. That's how they know their Lord. When rivers and trees and ground get thin, and cold it can be in a hard winter night, please see if they stay warm by the fire to keep them safe from any harm. Please be sure that His word don't go void. That it reaches to some lost sinner's soul. Please be sure that He wrote the gold on. Cause that's how they know the Lord. Wonder if y'all remember them in prayer as they traveled on the country road. Many times they've often prayed. Even my night call the morning out. Please be sure that His word don't go void. That it reaches to some lost sinner's soul. Please be sure that His word don't go void. And that's how they know their Lord. When traveling along country roads with the warmth from the fire, meet your face. Remember that who travels afar, for He's always been there more than, for He's always been there for you. In the same month of April when I wrote this, another thing happened just before my niece went out. was at home having my devotion in the morning in my office. I know your pastor. His office is almost like, where's the door? Mine is turning into that one. But I was sitting at my desk having my devotion time, getting ready to go to church. And when I closed my Bible, and I had a phone call, which is a video phone, special phone to death. And I see them live on TV, back and forth. But I got this call, I don't know this name, don't know this number. So I'm, okay, fine, find out who it is. Now I got to go to church. So I answered the phone. There was an old lady in there. Her hand was covered with white pills. When I saw white pills, I knew instantly what that meant. She was ready, finished, suicide. And knowing myself, try suicide 6 times in my life, I know that experience. And I realized the Lord did that day for me. Because he knew he could use me to help her. So really, I had begged her to please don't take it. Give me 1 hour. I don't want to show you. I'll be back 1 hour. And she was crying, she was screaming, she was ready to take it. 1 hour. Okay. I cannot think. I sped through all the speed limit there was except the red light. And I had to sit there. And then when I made it to church, talking to my pastor like I do her, they ran and left and came back, come! And I told him about that lady. Do you want me to stay here during Sunday school church time? Or go home and deal with her? He knew my mind would not be. He knew my mind would be on her. So he told me to go home and take care of her. Thank you. I'm proud of my pastor. Later, I watched him grow up. The season is past. So I sped through all the speed limits again. Ran in the house, dropped everything, including Angel. She was so confused. Ran to my office and hollered back. But he goes, no. When she answered the phone, there she was. Good. Not good, but I mean good, she didn't take it. And I asked, what's wrong? With one hand silent, she said, I lost my husband of 50 years. And I said, oh. So knowing that means 2 hands to communicate. So with a good excuse, would you mind put that down? Because I don't want her to take it while she's communicating with me. But she put it down. Good. All right. Husband, it should be totally dependent on him. For everything. She doesn't know what to do. She doesn't know how to live without her husband. She doesn't know that. And I'm telling her I've never been married and have no plans to, but living with a couple of families, I know, plus watching people. I'm not married, but I have a husband. How can you not have a husband when you're not married? If you don't mind, I'll tell you about it. And she sat there crying and grieving. Your husband, maybe God, that this someone else can be your husband now if you want him. Ah, without running, without the rest. You want him. The same thing with that boy. I told her about the love of Jesus Christ. I told her how he can help and be there and support and provide relief from A through C. I told him I took care of his own. He took him. And I told him flat out, all in Northern Hell and Satan, all that thing. But your husband can make it. If you can depend on him 100, 200, 300, 500% more than your own. And I was sitting there for 3 hours dealing with this green letter. My heart was, my mind was, about everything, and I'm looking back and remembering, and she said something I had said before I was sick. Life is not worth living. Mm-hmm. And I thought, life is worth living for Jesus. And she went ahead, and the third hour of dealing with her, I went. She got saved in my office, and after 300, I'm about to pull up my whole office down. I went crazy. I go crazy when someone gets saved. Believe me, I do. I can't sit still when I'm telling, praying somebody gets saved. I go crazy. I love seeing people get saved. But she is willing to take and finish her life. And I see so many other people in my 30 years, 167 last year, 53 so far this year. When I see souls saved, it means I lack to this old people. But when it's broke, and you're missing, and why I wrote that song, remember that. I can't quit, not for the sake of my death, but especially not for the sake of my Lord. I can't. I'm going to keep on going. My knees ready to go out, knees surgery bad. I'm trying to convince the doctor that he won't listen. But as long as my heart is going in my hands, I can do it, and I'll keep on going. But the Lord's trying to help me. And there was an old song from way back, 1972, when it first was. I loved it. Took me many years to look for it. Till about 2 years ago, I worked hard to learn this song. Kim Davis. Gutsy woman. But those who are them are like tigers. I've been rammed in the stomach from witnessing to younger. I've been turned in the suit at all kinds. Missionaries out there are being killed for giving the gospel. Many of the deaf out there I've witnessed have lashed in my face from saying, shut up! Leave me alone. My word before. One thing you can't do is force the gospel down somebody's throat. That's the Holy Spirit. Feel it, child. That's it. And I'm no preacher. But I only. But when we see things going upside down the way it is right now, I've already heard stories not long ago, missionaries in other countries being killed, babies' heads blown, cut off. There's Christians down there blown, killed by ISIS. Now they're coming, and folks are being killed here in America. And that's them. Said somebody killed them. But my question is, are you ready? Change your mind.